Osman is an amazing entrepreneur, and I was so excited when I read his bio for the first time. But I know of the companies that he started. I read about them, and I was, you know, in one way softly engaged with a business that actually overlapped with what he did. So quickly, briefly, because he's going to talk and he's going to bring out all of the experiences. So he co-founded No, which was funded by top-tier VCs and, of course, was acquired. Of course, he was a CEO as well. It's one of those companies that were at the cutting edge of technology, interactive ebook technology that was just emerging in those days. You know, so in my opinion, he was ahead of the time. You know, so then, of course, he co-founded again and was CEO of Chegg, which actually went IPO on the New York Stock Exchange. And he is really a true serial entrepreneur. We hear that word a lot in the Thai circles, but when you talk about somebody coming in knowing exactly what to do and creating something unique, you know, I would say that it's really an honor to introduce Osman today. So his latest gig is something also very exciting and timely. It's in the space of learning, education, and of course, very unique style to it. I'll just leave it at that. It's called Galxyz. I'm pretty sure you all received this email with his bio on it, but you know, I'll let him come in and speak to us about his experiences. Osman.
All right. Thank you so much, Ram. That was a fantastic introduction. When Raj first told me about doing my story, my initial reaction was, I don't like to self-promote. This is not something that I'm comfortable with. And he came back with a really good point that this is not about my list of accomplishments, but more about how I got to this point. And I was like, that's something I think I'll enjoy doing. Now, as I was thinking about this, you know, I went down pretty long memory lane on all the past and things I did. I was trying to figure out that, okay, so I like starting companies, I like to solve problems. So from my, you know, family, where did this come from, right? So it's my story, starts with my parents. Now, the interesting thing is, I couldn't find anything because my parents, my dad was a government employee, right? And he used to take small risks, but not a lot of risks. My mother was a homemaker, and my uncles were also in the government, so there was no one really going and doing business. And I was like, where is all this coming from? I also remember that I wasn't really inspired as a kid to go and open a lemonade stand to do a small business, so it wasn't coming from there either. You know, so I kept digging deeper and deeper into where you know, where some of these habits were coming from. And one thing I did notice that my parents used to take small risks, and one thing they kept telling me, we'll figure it out, let's try something out, and we'll see where it goes. And I think I may have taken that to the next level because I really like risks, and I thrive on that. And so those were some of the things which I thought about. Now, I also knew that I was a good student. In elementary, I used to top in my class, but by the time I got to middle school and high school, I absolutely found school boring, and I was just trying to get my way through it in most of the time. Many of the images and thoughts that came back to me was me trying to manage the consequences of my pranks and being naughty as a kid, was where I think I learned a lot of things on how to deal with situations on the fly. Because you know, and I'll tell you some of these stories that you poke something, not really sure what's going to happen, and then you have to deal with it. So quite a few stories and things that jumped in my mind were how I would try to do something and on the fly, right then and there, I had to manage the situation and figure my way out of it. And I think that's really where a lot of my skills as an entrepreneur developed over time. Now, in terms of my own profile, I do believe I have a very active imagination, even to the point where sometimes I'm like, whoa, where did the hour go? Because I was just in deep in thought. I am detail-oriented, but only when I care, which drives my wife absolutely crazy. I'll tell you that much. But, you know, if I, once I set my mind on doing something, it goes by like this, but then it's not very often that I want to do some of those things. Another interesting thing is that I really prefer to understand the broad spectrum of things, how are things connected, and how do they influence each other, versus really going down the rabbit hole of many of these things. Because fundamentally, I believe by the time you get to the rabbit hole, things are moving so fast that things have changed around. And how do you figure out what's happening in the ecosystem, what things are impacting each other, and keep that into perspective more than going down in the minutiae of details? You obviously need to understand some of those details, but I also tend to believe that too much experience can wear you down, because then you always figure out why things didn't work, and your thinking can get limited because of that. I'm also allergic to too much planning. I can tell you that I'll think a little bit about it, but I'll do a lot more on-the-fly planning there as well. You know, which makes me think sometimes that, you know, I can make a case for maybe I have undiagnosed ADD when I was a kid, which my parents never figured out, but I can make an equally strong case that I don't have it based on some of the things I've done. So going back to, you know, to my parents, my father was born in India, in Palwal, which is 50 miles from Delhi. It used to be Punjab back then. And my mother was born in Panipat, which is also in Punjab, famous for quite a few wars, and so we used to give her a hard time about that all the time. They migrated to Pakistan in the 40s, and typical, you know, Desi family, what you find is, you know, over time, the, you know, people begin to think, okay, so where are we really from, and where do we go, right? I mean, in Pakistan, many people really like to think they have their descendants from Saudi Arabia and things like that. So I decided one day with 23andMe coming out to figure out, okay, where are we really from? Because, you know, both sides of the family are saying pretty awesome things. They're like, whoa, we must be the best family ever. Turns out, my mom is a Mongolian, and my dad was from Northern Europe. Nothing to do, 0.01% came from Arab, right? But the thing is, you know, it's so amazing that when you really step back and take a look, where are you really from? It doesn't matter, right? Because I only told it to a few people because I didn't want to break any hearts. Tell them, you know, you're really not a descendant of Muhammad. You're from Mongolia, right? You're maybe a Khan at best, right? So you know, but we, you know, some of the things we did that. Now, my parents, obviously, they had faced a lot of adversity when they moved to Pakistan, and they had farms in India. When they moved, they had nothing, and they had to build everything from scratch, the entire families. So quite a few interesting things happened over there, and I think those are some of the things. As my father took risks multiple times in his career, I saw him moving for the better, and those things just began to over time ingrain in my thinking as well. Now, I am number 5 from the top. We are 7 kids. So I'm glad it was really beneficial for me that we had a big family. We are 4 sisters and 3 brothers. So we, from a big family, down the totem pole, you know, you get beaten up a lot. And, you know, so that also builds you up, I think, as you go. So my father, at some point, became a diplomat. And he was Pakistan's diplomat, and he in multiple countries, and he was posted to the UK, and I was born there in 1970. So I'm going to try to cover 45 years in 45 minutes or less, and hopefully give you enough insights. So I was born in London. Now, as he was a diplomat, he lived in many other places in Africa, and so some interesting things happened for me over there. But I was in the UK for 3 years. When I first went to Pakistan, I couldn't speak a word of Urdu. I was afraid of flies. You know, so as time went by, in the next 3-4 years, you know, got more accustomed to living in Islamabad. In the mid-70s, right, when I think the day we left Pakistan for Ghana, where my father's next posting was, Ziaul-Haq was hanged by the regime. I still remember on the radio as we were driving, the news coming out that he was just hung. So, you know, many of these things, remember, stick with you as you're going through your life. Now, in Islamabad, I just want to make sure I don't skip something. I was asking my sister, hey, any funny stories about me when I was a kid? She was much older than me. And the one thing she said, you have to say this no matter what, that I gave up the bottle really late. And she's like, the things we had to go through to make sure that in kindergarten your bottle arrived at school, but you didn't want any other kid to see you drinking from the bottle, and how, you know, we had to put a towel around you to so you can drink. And I was like, oh my God, how spoiled I was that I was still drinking a warm bottle of water at school in the middle of the day in kindergarten. So it made absolutely no sense to me. Now, my mother, she was a tomboy. So she had grown up on a farm, and she was always in did quite a few interesting things. But in our home, we almost had a farm. So we had from dogs and cats and chicken and rabbits and all different kind of animals. And we really engaged a lot with them, even to the point that once did she decided to get some swans in our home. And you're like, you know, you're thinking, what are the swans going to do? And, you know, when my father's sister showed up once with wearing a nice big gharara, the swans just went crazy and started attacking her. I mean, they just went for the gharara, like we don't know why, but they just did. But again, you know, the whole interaction with the animals, and even I was thinking that when we had chickens and we had all these chicks and there were so many cats around, I just used to love the cat and mouse game with the cat and the chicken and how they were trying to come after each other, try to eat them. And I would let it play out almost to the edge, then stop the cat from eating the chicks. Because, you know, again, I really feel, thinking back, that many of these small little incidents in life, they are starting to wire you in a certain manner, which I think stay with you for life. And I'm going to come back to this later on, but this is why I really believe education gaming is so critical for kids. Because when you're playing a game, a kid sees so many things happening at them that they have to deal with quite a few things at the same time. And the more gaming they can do in an earlier life, the brain actually develops in a really different way. But, you know, we'll come back to that in a little bit. So then from Islamabad, as I was saying earlier, we had gone to Ghana. And I felt that was, you know, some of the best years of my life, because I was, for the first time, in a completely new culture. And we had to figure out a way how to make friends. And with, you know, coming from Pakistan, you have no notion of what is Africa about, what are Africans about. And, you know, in how we had to deal with the entire situations living in Ghana was, on one hand, you have, you know, you're the child of an ambassador, a chargé d'affaires. So you're flying, you're walking around, you're driving around in a flag car. But on the other hand, you have to, it's so much poverty over there that you see it so close that you really have to develop a respect for the people who are building the businesses on the ground over there. And some of the best experiences I had were buying, or, you know, products from people on the street, and they were so great and friendly to work with that the whole notion began to develop in me that, look, you know, there's no such thing as a level, right? We just need to work with people, and because there's some really great people out there at all different levels that you can work with. Now, in Ghana, I understood about gender equality. I was in fifth grade, and as I said, you know, in elementary school, I was a good student. And my number one, you know, competition was this Indian girl called Manju. I still remember her name. And we were neck and neck on everything. This was in Ghana. It was, you know, it was a school over there, and I just realized, I still remember that thinking, because when you grow up in Pakistan, you have a different biases. But when you're in a completely neutral environment, first time I understood, girls can kick your butt. And you know, it's totally cool for that to happen, and you know, something you have to accept. And I think that's one of the things I've really taken with me throughout my life as I've done things on gender equality and being fair in some of those things. But that's where, when I was thinking about it, for the first time, that memory popped up of my realization of that. Now, you know, I'll just move forward because I want to talk a little bit more on the back end of, you know, of my life. But coming back to Islamabad, this is now seventh grade. And so far, I still don't know how to write Urdu or read Urdu. And in Pakistan schools, you really, really must learn Urdu because Urdu is a compulsory topic, right? So now the way the school system works that you're allowed to fail in two topics out of 11, and they'll push you right along. But they won't give you a position in the class. They'll just say nil, right? So I remember going through all of seventh grade, nil. I mean, I got everything else going, but I was just struggling with Urdu and Islamiyat, where it got to the point, and somehow I was like, you know, I'm just not spending enough time trying to learn it, where one of my teachers, I gave a test in Urdu, and my handwriting was so bad. And, you know, he went through the first question, he looked at the essay, he gave me 8 out of 20. And then he just scratched everything off. So I got 8 out of 100. So what happened next? For the next year, he called me 08. Every day he would come to class and I would dread that he's going to come and ask me. He'll say, 08, top of the class. He'll make me stand there and he'll ask me the toughest words in Urdu. And for me, it's like, you know, imagine you speaking Hindi and suddenly somebody's going to ask you something in Sanskrit. Like, what? Where did that come from? So I actually spent quite a few years of my, you know, 8th and 9th grade dreading that Urdu period, yet not really saying, you know, not really focusing enough to really become great at it, but just to get by. So quite a few, you know, it's funny, when I think of my school days, it's more memories about pranks and things we did than actually sitting and learning, because when I look back at it, the learning was really terrible. I mean, in Pakistan, unfortunately, back in those days, if you failed at everything else, you became a teacher. It's a reality. I mean, and when that happens, the teacher doesn't want to be there, right? And the moment you say something, you're in trouble, because the concept is, oh, your teacher is, in terms of respect, comes right after your father. So you know, you have to show respect, in which means they can also slap you around. You know, so all that is fair game, and I promise you this. After he said, 08, come here, you know, literally like this in the classroom, I'm standing here, he puts my collar down, and he's got his hand on my neck, and he's asking me questions, and I'm waiting for him to go, like every day, right? So every day was one of those things which would happen. At some point, you know, I just got so used to it. Now, one of the funniest stories, actually, I have from my... from that era of my life was, so my father had a heart attack and he was going to the UK for a bypass surgery. Back then, you know, you had to fly out and he was getting quadruple bypass. And, you know, so we are strapping 10th graders, right, you know, and somehow the thought comes into my head and my friend's head, that, you know, I think we need some magazines because you can't find, you know, Playboy in Pakistan. And there's a whole strategy on, okay, so how are we going to utilize this trip to bring the magazines back in Pakistan? So now we are 6 of us, we've got a whole plan down, how will we get them through customs, how will I get the money to buy it, where do I hide it? And there's a whole production going on, and I executed well against it, because for the 1 month I was in London, I would save 15 pence here, 50 pence here, a pound here, and I got $25. Now, what I never thought was I have to walk into the store and buy, and I walk in and there's this young girl standing there and I'm like, how will I buy these and take it to her? So throughout for the next 10, and now she saw me walking around the store, she probably knew why I was there, but I was too shy to go do it. So finally I do it, I still remember never looking up. Right? I just, you know, just gave her the money and just, you know, got the hell out of there. And so back then we used to have these bags, you know, where you could, you know, if they were round bags, you could unzip and make them taller and taller, longer and longer. So I convinced my mother that, okay, we really needed 2 out of 3 sections for bags, otherwise get too heavy, came up with some argument, and decided to roll all the magazines and, you know, open the zip, stuff them around in there, and close the zip, and it was a go. Now, there was one problem left, that customs in Pakistan, you know, that could be a problem. So
work with a friend who had a friend who had a friend who was going to show up and make sure that this particular package went right through. Again, we had the whole plan. Now, this is 1986, bypass surgery is a big, big deal. Your whole family shows up, right? So we land at the airport, we go in. Islamabad airport, you know, there was, at that point, security was pretty easy. You know, family member could come all the way to the gate, right? All the way to the door of entrance. So, walk in and boom, I see 50 family members with car and, you know, with flowers and everything. I'm like, okay, all right, that's good. So as we're going through it, we're meeting everyone. One custom guy comes and takes the bag and he just walks away with it. And so I'm standing there and I'm sweating. And I'm standing under an air-conditioned roof and air conditioner. My sisters are kind of making fun of me. Hey, you were in the UK for a month. You can't handle heat anymore. You know how sisters can be, right? I mean, this is going on and on. But on the corner of my eye, I'm seeing the bag going away. And I have this vision of you can open the zip and they will explode out. My entire family, auntie, everyone are going to see it. And so now I'm standing there trying to improvise right on the spot. How the hell do I stop this bag from going further and further? And the guy didn't show up, right? I mean, that's where the plan failed, right? So we had a plan, it didn't work out. So how are we going to improvise on the spot? Luck as would have it that my uncle has showed up and said, oh, no, we didn't have to check these bags. So he had a friend there as well. And we got the bag through customs. But I still remember clearly the sweat cup pouring down and the bag, this maroon bag walking away from me. And I'm looking at it like, oh my God, I'm going to be embarrassed for the rest of my life. Now, we got it through. I became one of the most popular boys in Islamabad. Suddenly, the list of friends grew really, really long. Everybody wanted to be my buddy because this was gold, right? I mean, just like in Pakistan, buying any of these things is just like gold, right? I mean, so there's a whole hundreds of stories around those magazines that I won't get into. But you know, the other really interesting thing is a career decision, which kind of shows you how crazy things can be in a school in Pakistan. So at the end of 10th grade in Pakistan, you have to choose pre-medical or pre-engineering.
Wow.
At the end of 10th grade, you've got to make a decision. Yeah. And my score in biology and math was exactly the same.
Wow.
Yeah. Yeah. So my score was exactly the same, and I actually felt I could go either way. A lot of my really good friends were going into engineering. Some of my friends were going into medical. I kind of like the white coat thing. I'm like, hey, that can be a cool thing. I should go become, you know. I was undecided until I walked to the door of the vice principal who would give you the seat in different sections. So as I step in, I said, okay, I'm going to go to medical. All right, I walk in and I go to him and, you know, he was in his final year. He was a really awesome guy, white beard, big hat. He was sitting there. And I said, sir, I'm going to go, sir, over there. And I said, I want to go into pre-med. And he goes, son, I just closed the register. Why don't you become an engineer? He was right there. He just had to just flip it open, put my name in, and say, son, I just closed it, become an engineer. And here I am in engineering. Right? I mean, when you look back and think about it, you're like, holy crap, right? I mean, my parents absolutely, you know, didn't know, again, one of seven, right? They left the decision to me to figure out what I was going to do. But that was my decision of going this way or that, but nowadays, how much thought goes into what are you going to do? And that was it. You just have to write a name in the register. So, but again, you know, it's just crazy, right? How some of these things go down. Now, I used to play a lot of cricket. Something I learned with cricket was just be patient, your opportunity is going to come. I was really good at cricket. And had there been an infrastructure in Pakistan, I could have gone into cricket because I just played a lot of it. And, you know, so I was on many different teams and just had a great time playing the game. But so now, you know, I get through high school. It's time to come to the US. And I had a British passport, so I didn't have to worry about getting a visa. I could just fly in. So, you know, so that also helped me not plan too much. So I decided to come into Chicago, flew to Chicago, and check things out. Do we need a mic?
No.
We need it for the recording.
For the video. Yeah. Okay. Right. So I come to Chicago, and spend a week in Chicago, and I decide Chicago is not for me. Somehow I figured out I wouldn't make it in Chicago. And I had a really good friend at the University of Minnesota from high school. And there were actually four of us who went to University of Minnesota together. So I called him up, I'm gonna get on a train and I'm coming tomorrow, come pick me up.
Now, by the way, so on the train ride, you see all these stories, right? You know, people come from the overseas, they don't know any of the sports team's name and this and that. And you know, so I'm on the train and there's this young girl who I think was in 9th or 10th grade at best. But she was in a rebellious stage and she was, you know, having a hard time with her mom and her mom was asking her to do this and that, but she wasn't listening. So she wanted to come and talk to me. So she was going to Washington. So we started talking and so she says, she goes, I really like baseball. Now, I have no idea what baseball is. I'm like, yeah, I heard the Minnesota Vikings are really good, which is a football team. I mean, this actual moment that you see in the movie is that the fresh off the board kid comes in and says the exact wrong thing. It's actually true. It happened to me. And then I only found out about a month later that you know, there's no such thing as a Vikings baseball team. But it was a funny thing you see in the movie actually happened to you. And I was just FOB, right? Fresh off the board. Now, so I go to Minnesota. I have no admission. I walk in the admission office and say, hey, can I apply? I did bring my degrees with me, so you know, I thought I'll need them. And I got into University of Minnesota, and it was a culture shock for me just to study there, because in Pakistan, you only have to study for 2 months of the year, the last 2 months before your exams. Because there's only one exam you take. Everything else doesn't matter, because the final exam you take in March or April of every year, that matters. So right when February comes around, you wake up and you say, oh, I better start to study, right? Minnesota, quarter system. First week, the midterm had an impact on the grade. We're like, holy cow. I mean, how do we deal with this? So, you know, there was a whole learning thing that we had to go through. And then secondly, a decision I made was, as I said, my father, you know, we had seven siblings. I wasn't going to take any money from my dad. I was going to get a job, and we'll figure out a way to get through college ourselves. And so I had no actual skills, because in Pakistan, you kind of, you know, never really developed any of those skills in the early days. And the only job I could find was cleaning bathrooms. And it's not just, you know, a nice bathroom. I'm talking about a bathroom at the student union basement, where it's kind of dark, right? It's like you. This is something that it's in your nightmares you don't want to do. Now, I remember this again, you know, these are some of the things that jumped to my mind as I was thinking about these things, was, you know, I remember going in the bathroom, the first time to clean it, throwing up and coming back out, made things worse for myself, right? Then went in again and threw up and came out. I mean, this was really like hell to go in there. But the third time I went in, kept it in, I was able to clean the bathroom. And I think that was the first time I realized that I could actually do anything if I set my mind to it, because I still remember the guy coming down, the head janitor coming down and say, huh, you didn't quit. Right? He was shocked that I was there. And then, and the good thing was, he was a nice guy. He said, you know, just do a couple of the bathrooms. They get dirty really fast. You can just do your homework. Don't worry about it. But thank God I got, you know, I took a program class and I was able to get a great programming job from that point on. And never had to clean a bathroom. But that was one crazy week I had to go through. But I think, you know, it was one of the best things that happened to me, cleaning that bathroom, because I think it built something in me which gave me the confidence that whatever comes at me, I should be able to handle it. Now, University of Minnesota is where I met my future wife. She was an Indian Hindu, and I was a Pakistani Muslim. So, you know, I won't go through any of the crazy stories, but, you know, let's just say it took us 8 years to get married. So, you know, both sides of the parents were like, is there no one else in the world for you? I mean, have people disappeared from everywhere else? Why this one? And I think both of us experienced true love, and we were like hell-bent on like, this is it, and this is how it's going to be. And, you know, that's also when I began to question quite a few different things about socially with religion and many different things which impacted me to this day on how we need to, you know, why everyone should be the same. And, you know, these are things which I'm saying which are normal, but as you experience it and you really realize fundamentally what they are, I think that's became a part of my own personality as time went by. Now, I could write a book on the relationship and the craziness around it, but I won't. Needless to say, we successfully got married in 2000 after breaking up 3-4 times, but ended up, you know, making the best decision of our lives.
Now, right around this, I also graduated. I did double E, electrical engineering. And Minnesota was one of the only few places where they gave financial aid to foreign students. Not financial aid that you didn't have to pay back. And I'm talking about $30,000 a year. We're not talking about little money over here. It's one of the only few universities who used to do that. And, you know, so that was the plan. We'll go in, not take money from parents, and get financial aid. Now, turns out they only give financial aid to 1 or 2% of the students. So this is no slam dunk by any stretch of the imagination. And I think some of the darkest days were for me when you would get the letter, oh, you didn't get financial aid, what are you gonna do about it? And then, you know, then you wake up the next morning and then you go and grovel with the counselor, and we figured out a way to stay on financial aid for the next 2 years by just really convincing them every time, because there's so many people there that qualify. You really have to go above and beyond to make that happen. I don't think I would have graduated from college if Minnesota wasn't giving financial aid, which is why I have a huge respect for the university and I support it in many different ways. Now, so I graduated and double E degree, and you know, towards the end, I was like, is this something I really want to do? You know, but as a foreign student on financial aid, I'm like, you bet I am, because I want to get through college, because I need to get to the other side here, because who's going to pay the bills? But it turns out, so I did microelectronics, which is how do you make machines on chips, which is very sophisticated work, but very tedious. You know, it's very, you know, like, you change something small, you wait for 3 hours, and it go change.
So I, you know, I worked as an engineer for only 3 months because I found it not in line with my personality, because I had to be in a lab all day long with a bunny suit on, gloves, handling sulfuric acid, and just waiting and waiting, do something and wait. And I'm like, this is just not me. So I decided to, okay, I'm not going to do engineering. And again, you know, this is like, what? I mean, my friends were like, are you crazy? What else are you going to do? You're a foreign student. You know, you don't exactly have a lot of options. So in the middle, I'm saying, you know what? I'm going to go to Pakistan. I'm going to go back to Pakistan. I'm going to see what's going on over there. And decided to go back to Pakistan and say, hey, let me check out the work environment over there. Needless to say, that didn't work out too well when I found out that all they want to do is come and have a cup of tea and then we'll talk, right? A lot of tea goes on. And this is back in, you know, in the mid-90s, the infrastructure wasn't there as much. It's done amazing things since then. But when I went back, I felt I couldn't survive. And somehow I got back in the US with 1 day left on my F1, on my visa. I can't believe they let me through. But I think having, you know, the British passport may have helped me. But I got through. Then now the next problem was, okay, now you have 90 days to extend your F1 visa. What are you going to do? So I was like, look, I need to change the label on my forehead. I'm not an engineer, so what do? I'm like, MBA program. You gotta go back to school, get the MBA program. Now, Minnesota is very tough. They don't allow you to get in the MBA program if you don't have 2 years of work experience. I didn't have that. I mean, it was pretty evident, you know. But somehow, again, that's a long story there. I won't go through it. I managed to get myself into an MBA program, which I found was a great program, but again, was not for me because I had people with 15 years of experience talking about product problems and general mills and things like that. And I'm like, what are they talking about? This makes no sense. But I knew I had to change my tag on my forehead. So using the tag, I got my first job in a business side, and which was writing brochures for a computer telephony product. Computer telephony was becoming huge. IVR, you could call in the bank, and you know it was all new back in 1994. So then from there, I you know it was a kind of a part-time job. I was trying to get a full-time one, and I joined a startup. This Israeli guy, Ilan Sharon, he had himself immigrated from Israel, and he had a software company for 4GL programming. And he knew my experience in computer telephony, and he said, you know, I'm trying to open a division in computer telephony. Why don't you come and help me do that? Now, I had no business saying, oh, sure, I can make it happen. And he had no business trusting me because I had no skills that technically I should have had. But something he saw in my attitude and my aggressiveness, he said, hey, you had nothing to lose. Like, let's go do it. Now, I think I learned most of my startup chops from that company because I was a one-man show for a whole year. And we accumulated that year by getting American Express as our first customer. For this product which was built in Israel, came to the US, had no customers. But again, it was one of those things that we convinced American Express why we would do such a great job for them, and we got them as a client. But again, it was a classic story in which we had no business really winning that account or delivering this product. And as it turns out, the group did so well, the one that I had started, that it took over the company. We shut down all of the divisions. And that was the company that got acquired by a South African company 2 years afterwards. So joined it in 94. By 97, the company was acquired by a company called Atio. And I was there with Atio for another two and a half years. And I became VP of marketing, VP of business development. And I had learned a lot of things during this process because there were many firsts. In a new company, there's so many firsts. And we just can't make an excuse why we can't do it. And that became my instinct that, all right, if it's not been done before, let's go do that because it's probably more fun. That's how I really developed some of the skills for that. Now, right then around, you know, Silicon Valley was going crazy. And I was like, oh man, I'm wasting my time in Minnesota. I got to go to the Valley. And so once again, H1 visa. You better have another job so you can transfer your visa. You just don't leave it. But I'm like, yeah, screw it. I'm going to go to Silicon Valley and we'll see what happens. I pack up my stuff in my car and I drove to California to hang out, stay with a friend. Now, I met a few people and I was able to get my startup going. And it was called Gravity Well. And this is the year 2000. There's no notion of software as a service. Back then, it even came out in 2005, 2006. But the company that I really wanted to build, building on my experience on customer service, was I wanted websites to have a button for customer service that they click and they can give customer service without ever installing a piece of software. So this was really, there's no infrastructure in your building, everything's gonna work on the servers, and that's what we're gonna do. So I got basic funding for it. We got five customers for it, but then Silicon Valley went crazy. There was a bust came, right? But the thing was that we still had money, but I still gave the money back to the investors because I realized a big fundamental problem in the company, that I had a co-founder who was a parallel entrepreneur. There's something to be a serial, there's something to be a parallel. I mean, he would like to open four companies and dealing with everyone, and he's never around. And my question was, if there's a problem, if there's a fire in all your companies, which company are you going to go to? And I bet it's not mine. So I decided that the biggest lesson I learned over there was choose your co-founder, choose your partner really, really carefully, because they can grind you down. And that 18 months was such a burnout for me that when I joined the next company called Cordiant, you know, I could do my job in 20 hours a week, but I think I browsed the internet, right? I mean, I was so good at my work because I have all these skills that you know, they didn't have enough stuff for me to do that I think I browsed the internet where nothing was left to browse on the internet after I got my job done. So, but at Cordiant is where I, for the first time, I think I engage with top level sales and marketing people, where I'm like, whoa, that's what we're talking about when you're talking about how to sell, how to treat customers. This is the level you have to aspire to be. And so after a few months, I was really burnt out of browsing the internet and doing my job really quickly. I decided, all right, maybe I should try to move inside the company. Made a couple of moves, eventually convinced the head of sales to let me sell. And we were a financial services company, and we would sell products mostly on the East Coast and Europe, and there were no customers on the West Coast. And I was like, hey, I'll try to sell to the West Coast, you know, give me a chance, right? I think we can sell product over here. And they had nothing to lose. But the most interesting thing was that in a company where there were no demos for, you know, how to sell to a mortgage company, or how to sell to a telco, or how to sell to the largest bank in the world. These were the deals that we did on the West Coast that I was involved in, because it didn't matter if we didn't have any of these things, because we just went in and we would say, we'll build it as we need it. Let's figure out what they're looking for and then go build a demo, because we believed our software could do the whole thing. So over there, I learned a lot from some amazing people, like how to sell, right? I mean, a CEO's job, you're selling all day long. You're selling to your employees, you're selling to your shareholders, you're selling to your customers. If you know how to sell, so many problems will just go away, because naturally you will understand how to do that. So that was the really important skill I picked up from at Cordiant, and was able to really sell customer service solutions to some of the best organizations in the world. And in the process, I learned how they treat their own customers. What does great customer service look like, and how do you deliver and really look after your customers and learn from that? Now, my style always has been, I'm very transparent with my managers. And so I was working closely with the chairman of the board, Sam Spadafora. And I told him, hey, you know, it's been 4 years now. I think I want to go do a startup. And he said, okay, I'll be your first investor. And then he introduced me to my next 10 investors for Chegg. So that's when I went and started Chegg. And Chegg was an amazing, amazing ride. For the record, plan A failed, and plan B is actually what worked. And plan A was simply that we wanted to make a hyper-local market for students on a campus to transact with each other, buy and sell with each other. The vision was that we would make 6,400 local markets. There were 6,400 universities, and eventually we'll tie them up into one system, and we'll be the Craigslist for colleges, essentially was the concept. Only problem was that whenever we opened a new campus, new site, lots of kids showed up, but there were more buyers than sellers. The rule in consumer marketing is your customers will show up twice, then they'll just abandon you. And we just found out the fundamental problem was that unless we spend a lot of marketing dollars to make sure the sellers are putting the product out there, the buyers will come and they won't find anything. But in the campuses where the product was working and it would go crazy in the first week, the other problem was there were two peaks in a semester, start and end. You also can't build a business around that. And we had thought that we can get the local merchants to put in coupons and food and things like that, but it was still too early days for that. The technologies around it didn't exist. But we found that textbooks were selling like crazy, and all these transactions were taking place, and kids were negotiating with each other. And then we realized, you know how much it used to suck in college that you pay $100 for a book, and one quarter later they give you $25 for it, and you feel like you just got ripped off? Like, hey, guess what? It's only gotten worse. And we're like, why don't we solve that? And the interesting thing is, so we moved to that model, in late 2006, 2007. And I don't think we could have built the company a year before because so many technologies that we needed to build that company were there. Now, Chegg's whole thing was, why buy when you can rent? And Netflix was all the rage, right? So Netflix really, really made it easier for us to explain that you can rent things online and use it and send it back. Now, you know, we did quite a few crazy things as part of Chegg, where when we shipped the first 3,000 books, we didn't have a warehouse. We didn't know where they were going to come back. We're like, hey, we'll figure it out on the other side because we have 90, 91, 20 days, and we did figure it out. I still remember, I mean, we did some incredible things where 7 people did the work of 30. At one point, we were turning away 90% of people on our website trying to rent books because we couldn't handle the volume, right? We didn't even have the money to, because we had to buy the books ourselves, right? Or pay for the book up front, and then we wouldn't get the book would become profitable after it was rented 2.3 times. That was eventual model that we had to work. So somebody had to pony up the cash to pay for the books. Now, the other thing was, how do you predict which books are going to rent, right? And now again, I'm getting into small individual decisions which were monumental to the success of the company, because had we taken these wrong decisions, we wouldn't have existed. We said, you know what? Why don't we do just in time? Why don't we take the order, run like hell to Amazon, Harv.com, and have them ship the book to them, so at least we got 60% of the money we needed for the book. We only have to come up with only less than half of it. Now, that model worked really, really well, but it came back with its slew of problems. Now, thousands and thousands of kids are on the site, and they're all renting 2, 2.5 books from us. And Barnes & Noble one day decides that we must be some scam, and they canceled 1,200 books without telling us. So now the phone begins to ring. Where's my book? Now, these are kids who wait till the last minute to get their book, and now the homework and quiz depends on it. And now we have girls and students on the phone crying that because of you, I'm going to get a bad grade. You know, that's the kind of customer, that's the kind of issues we had to deal with. I mean, we had kids who would say, I never got my book, while the UPS code said the book was left at the doorstep. So the question we have, do we trust the customer or do we say you're lying? Now, we said we're going to trust the customer, we're going to overnight them another book, and we'll see what happens. Now, it turns out that was one of the best decisions we ever made, because word got around that, those kids sent email to 50 other students that here's what happened. And in reality, only 0.1% of kids ever do that. And in our model, we had said we'll have 3% fraud. So let's just assume fraud and let's just deal with it. Let's not build the company for the 1% which will do fraud. Let's build for the 99% of customers that will love you. And that's when we set out to build the company. Now, there are many, many, Chegg is full of crazy stories, to the point where as we were doing just-in-time ordering, the American Express, we were using American Express at that time, they began to call us, hey, we're seeing a lot of microtransaction happening on your card, $50, $48, $56, is that fraud? According to the laws, you couldn't be doing some of the things we were doing, right? But we didn't know, we never checked. So we were like, okay, how do we solve the problem? We said, now we're opening a library. I mean, that became the standard excuse. I would sleep with a phone in my hand because American Express would call me at 3 a.m, threatening to shut the card down. And every night, so I don't know why they called it 3, but they just did. And every night, I had to convince them to walk them back from the ledge so we could continue ordering the book and the system didn't shut down. Eventually, to the point where my entire credit history was shot to hell. I would have thought my credit history would go great. I'm buying and selling, paying bills on time. But they were like, no, you're transacting too much. You're at risk because your salary doesn't show that you can support your buying history, right? I mean, at one point, you know, like we had gotten funding. A lot of good stuff was happening. We even put $2 million on the card, but they still wouldn't accept it. But we had to just come up with different ways to bring in gift cards, round robin gift cards and so many different things to make it work. But the thing is, we figured it out. As the problem showed up, we had to deal with it. Now, you know, we did crazy things as on, we decided to open our own warehouse. This is, I think, August. And we said by Thanksgiving, we'll have our own warehouse up and running as large as a football field. Now, when I look back, we did it a week before. And I never went and studied how does a warehouse system work or what are the software packages out there. Because I had learned from my enterprise software days, there's a lot of stuff out there that you don't need. People make a lot of buttons they have no business making. So we said, okay, what we need, pick, pack, and ship, print a label, get it out. We wrote our own warehouse software, which is still in production today, but it became the backbone of our company because we could get books in and out so fast that we would know that a book is coming in a box and here's a customer waiting for it. It would just automatically go on its way out and go to the next customer. Those are the kind of things, decisions we had to make as building the software as we went. Now, Chegg was doing fantastic. It was on a roll. It was crazy. And this is in 2010 or 2009, we said, okay, we want to go do an IPO. Now, I personally, more of a builder than a manager. I don't enjoy 10, 11 VPs reporting to me. I would rather be building. So I was thinking of, okay, let's bring a CEO who's going to really take the company public, and I want to go build. No. Because I had started thinking about, okay, what disrupts Chegg? So my philosophy is, who is going to take me out of business? I should be the one, or how do we figure that out? Now, that's where it started. What ended up happening was that we wanted to actually build an education platform for K-12 and college, right? How would we build a whole platform, including hardware? So we set out building an iPad-type device even before the iPad was announced. And we built it in 12 months. I had no business building hardware. I had never built hardware before. We built the whole stack. But then, the story for No was that when iPad came out, it was just such a phenomenal product. Nothing could survive. I went to CES, 70 Android tablets were coming out. And we decided that let's go become a software play. Let's work on all the platforms. And eventually, No was acquired by Intel Education, and I'm happy to say, on its way of becoming one of the largest education platforms in the world, because Intel sells to countries. They sell to the Ministry of Education, who deploy for entire countries. So quite a few different amazing things will happen with No. Now, a lot of people ask me, so why did I start Galxyz, the next company? And, my philosophy is, what is it that I'm going to do? I know that if I go on vacation in 2-3 days, I'm kind of getting bored of it. I also think the way modern technology is going, especially with healthcare, barring something crazy happening, I may be around for another 50, 60 years. I may live to be 100. You just don't know. I was talking to an entrepreneur who's like 24 just last week, and I said, you could be alive for another 100 years. Just let that sink in. That, what would be the point of hanging it up? I have no need to do what I'm doing, but for me, this is just something I really, really enjoy. And I think it's also good for your brain if you're active and you're doing things. And I opened Galxyz mainly because of my own two daughters who were 11 and 7 at the time, that I was helping them with some science stuff, and turns out there was hardly anything good in education gaming for science. They had Angry Birds on one hand, amazing products, but when you look at science, they had second grade graphics and things which like, wow, this is education. Kids were like, how can I get through it? What we wanted to do was, how do we take the quality, the narrative of a Pixar movie, the quality of a top-notch game, and the right science standards in a package that a kid would just fall in love with, right? I mean, it's no different than playing a top-notch game, but they're going through the game by using science to unlock levels, unlock doors, and learning about science. And we wanted to focus on the elementary stage of things, mainly because kids lose interest in science in elementary. By the time they get to middle school and high school, it's already becoming a lost case for kids who have left. And the New York Academy of Sciences, which is our partner here, they think this is at an epidemic level. of kids leaving science, and many of the problems we need to face in the future need many of these scientists. But not just, it's not just about getting a kid into science. If a child is exposed to science, their brain gets wired differently. Critical reasoning, problem solving, which you can apply to any field you want, but we just want to make sure that by with kids, if they enjoy science, how can we open their minds to the possibility, and how can they apply it any way they want? So we're you know, at Galxyz right now, we are, you know, 7 people strong, very small team. Once again, I have no idea how gaming works. I've never built a game before. We had to hire a couple of guys out of Hollywood to do the narrative. You know, they're a completely different breed than anything else I've worked with before. Gamers, game developers are different. So everything is different, which is what helps me get out of bed in the morning, because I'm not doing the same old thing. I'm in education, but education is such a broad field that I could keep going on, and we'll keep on finding really awesome things to do in education. I personally believe, you know, and there's you know, a lot of smart people who said the same thing, really smart people, that education is going to solve the problems faced by humanity over the next 50 years. At TICON, this is something that I was talking about. But education is one of those things where, you know, people say, so why education? And I'm like, why not education? I mean, isn't this the most important thing that we wanna pass on? So I'm just passionate about education, not because of a calling or anything like that. I'm just in it, I really understand it, and I'm just having a lot of fun doing it. But you know, all these things, as I've kind of walked you through many of the different things, it looks like I don't plan a lot, right? I mean, when I think about, my God, I should start planning something. I mean, many cases I just jump, and during the jump, I try to figure out what's going on. And then when you land, you take quick actions. I tend to, like, personally, I really believe that good people will land on their feet no matter where they jump, right? You'll just be able to make it. And with that philosophy, I think, you know, for entrepreneurship, it is such a great time to be an entrepreneur. This morning, I was talking to a company. So I believe in education, artificial intelligence, voice recognition, text-to-speech, many of these things are going to create some amazing systems in the future. And I was talking to this company today who now have an API that I can do voice recognition at the level of Siri or Android, and I can just plug it into my game and have it up and running in a month. But I don't have to do speech recognition. I don't have to do any of these things. Another company can give me text-to-speech. I can buy an off-the-shelf package for artificial intelligence, open source, and I can tweak it, and I can create the next generation system, never ever having to be an expert on voice or artificial intelligence, but being smart enough to know what you can leverage it. So I think, you know, the golden days for education are definitely ahead of us, because it's not really been touched by the internet as much. It's you know, it's hardly, the technology in the classroom is so poor that the good days are ahead of us. But I think the real fun part is that you really don't have to say, do I need to be an expert in this? All you gotta know is what you're trying to do and start to get in and tweak. And I think anyone can do amazing things. I mean, Chegg, Noah, and Galxyz, and I think whatever comes next is an example of not really having core understanding of an industry, which is, I think, the best way to disrupt it. Because you're not weighed down by what you can't do, but you're like, you don't know any better, right? So you don't worry about the stuff you don't know, because you just, let me go do this. Because if there's one core message that I've learned, just because it didn't work before, doesn't mean it's not going to work now. Chegg could not have worked in 2003, 2004. Chegg could work it only in 2006 because of a technology called web services. They really became huge. I could now ship a package to UPS. It could tell me where it is, and I could tell my customer. So all those things, you know, are just part of the whole thing. I'm really gone over my time, so I'll just open for questions.
Just to make sure that we moderated correctly. So we have about 15, 20 minutes left, you know, so we're going to do like 5 questions, please. And all of you know the rules here. no string questions and no speeches or comments, just basically a question. Keep it short, and we're going to do... How many people have questions? 1, 2, 3, 4. Five. Okay, that's pretty much. I'm going to give it back to Osman. And, oh, yeah, great. Let's go with this gentleman here.
Can I have a question about what are the... So, my name is Sanjay Vanskade. I'm in a job transition and trying to become an entrepreneur. So I left my job. So
awesome.
Okay. So question to you is, what are the obstacles in education? What I perceive is the education board, and there are some bodies sitting there controlling the education system in the country. And there was a show about a couple of years back on CNN about Norway is top in education because they changed the system. We are way, way behind in the US. So are those studies done, and what are those the obstacles you are having? That's the question.
Look, so I mean, in education, that is true for any country, right? The education boards and those guys, they have to be very careful as they move forward because they have to worry about efficacy. Is this thing going to work before they put their weight behind it? So by nature, something at the scale of a country is always going to be really, really slow. But you don't have to worry about solving for the country. Solve for the first 100 students. Focus yourself down. Who are my first 1,000 students? Who are my first 100,000 students? And what you will find, a big trend is happening in education, that more and more teachers are embracing technology as an enabler for them, not as a replacement of them. And over the next 2 years, this whole section is going to explode, where teachers will begin to recommend to parents, hey, start buying these products, you can use them. And when a teacher recommends a product, parents just buy it in 2 seconds. So don't worry about why all those big things. Just think of your product. Who is the first customer? Everyone has early adopters. They all have early adopters. You find the early adopters, keep your burn rate low so you can take a punch or two, right? But just focus on the way I think of product is, if nothing else existed in the world, would this kid playing my game enjoy this game or not? Would they like the service, right? At Chegg, we figured out, we had started growing, but we're not exploding. And we're like, why aren't we exploding? Turns out that every student thinks they're going to drop the class. What if they're going to drop the class? Now, reality is 3% drop the class. But all of them thought about it. The moment we said, if you drop a class, you can send your book back for free, you get 100% refund, it took off. Because we understood the challenge the customer was having. So my point to you is just, focus on your first customers and get started. Because anything you're starting thinking of building today is going to change 5 times before you get to where you are.
Next.
A lady over there, yeah. Hi, Osman. My name is Preeti. Thank you so much for the wonderful talk. I work in marketing at Nutanix, but at the same time, I support my husband. He's an entrepreneur in education space. That's my background. But my question for you, I'm curious to know, you had 3 education companies like back to back, right? Were there any customer relationships that you leveraged or, sort of even that reputation, what were some of those learning lessons that you got from across, 3 different companies that you did?
So the the biggest asset when you're taking companies, when you have multiple companies, could be the people that you bring along with you, right? Many entrepreneurs do that. I was thinking about this other day, that why do I keep doing this to myself, where I build a team from scratch every time? Because Chegg was a functioning organization, right? So I never moved any of the people from there. No was acquired by Intel, I never moved any of the people. Galxyz, we're building a completely new team. So one of the biggest benefits that tends to be true is you bring a team along and it's very easy to go. The benefit that I see is how it helps me is, especially in marketing, in press, in people talking about the companies, the products I'm building, because there's a reputation, so that helps me as an entrepreneur to use my brand to some degree to help the next company move forward. Other things, you have investors, right? Your investors come along with you. You have, I think the biggest thing is, as an entrepreneur, people think, okay, you're tried and trusted. So employees are also much easier for you to join. I think building a new team helps a lot if you have had success. Building a new team for a brand new person, you have to do a lot more selling and a lot more convincing. And that's where the selling skills come in very handy.
Next.
Hello, my name is Tejasvi. I'm an entrepreneur. You had three different companies with three different ideas. What is the necessity to build a new company each time? Why could it not be one company with three different products? And you already have the relationships with employees and everything. What, I mean, was it by choice you built new companies, or what is the
dynamic? It's absolutely by choice, because if you think of Chegg, Chegg is on its way to do an IPO, right? It's got a capital intensive business already. You drop hardware into it, it's not going to work as effectively, number one. Number two, all these companies are very different. Chegg was an e-commerce play, right? No was initially hardware and then became software services. And Galxyz is gaming. So the skill set that's needed for these companies is actually not from the same person either. So, you know, and you know, so my whole perspective on this is that Chegg is an entity going on its own in a slightly different market than No, and No will never intersect with Galxyz. So my personal choice is that, you know, to build from scratch and to build a great company, you have to really focus down on it very, very hard and be, you know, in the weeds with the company. And the only time you can do that, you have five or six people, you're focused on it, that's when I think you can really build a great company. I chose this path. Other people have done it other ways. You can open a lab. I just felt that I didn't enjoy having so many execs reporting to me, because it takes you really far away from building and takes you more into management. And there are some amazing people who are great managers. Dan Rosenzweig, the CEO of Chegg, he is phenomenal. I mean, he knows how to manage people, how to motivate them. He's just fantastic. And, you know, it's not a skill that I really have at that level. Neither have I really wanted to develop it. So I'd rather be building products.
Hi, my name is Anjali Gupta. I work at Coursera, where I source content from great universities in emerging markets. And here's my question for you is, what are the teaching rules that you're breaking with Galxyz? And which ones of those would you encourage all of us to watch for if we're interested in lifelong learning?
Okay. So the teaching rules. Before I jump into that, let me, you know, make one philosophical comment. Is we're building a product which we believe requires teachers, right? Teachers are very important because kids have to go somewhere. Now, the challenge we see in the market is our generation and the next generation are not going to be able to produce enough science teachers. So how does technology help with that? Say, you know, if you actually look at Las Vegas right now, the number one school where they have 3,000 teachers they can't find. So you can't find enough teachers. That in a school, you need maybe six science teachers, but you can only find two, right? What is better for the teacher and better for the student? If the underlying platform is actually teaching you more of the science, but the teachers are helping you do experimentation and how to apply it, that's a much better use of the limited number of teachers you have than trying to cram everyone to do everything. So I think the first thing technology is going to do, and hopefully not break, but improve on, is that even a English teacher or a math teacher can be in a classroom managing a classroom while the platform is teaching you what you need to know about science. And then when the time comes, the science teacher comes in and helps you do the experiment, the hands-on part of it. So we see this as a augmentation. But now when you go outside the US, you go to India, Pakistan, China, Russia, Brazil, Malaysia, so many places, they will never be able to produce enough teachers. Right? I mean, things are only getting worse. And platforms like Galxyz and even Coursera and many of these other things can do a lot more of the teaching. And there's still, you know, some level of artificial intelligence and things that need to come in to wrap it up. But in 5 years from now, I think we'll be in an amazing place.
So.
How many more have questions?
Hi, Osman. My name is Lingraj. I'm quite passionate about education, more so it started off with my daughter who's 6 years old. And one of the things that I think quite often these days is with the level of automation that's happening, I wonder what kind of skills will be left for human beings to do. And one of the things that I think about is STEM, I think, is a great way to start. And the other skill that I think will be quite important is innovative thinking, the kind of thinking that you do. Mm-hmm. And how then encouraging people around you to basically build, go through the ups and downs and succeed with that. So there are some core set of skills that I believe will be important. Is there something that you are doing in that space, apart from the science, in mm-hmm. terms of gaming, on how to teach innovative mm-hmm. thinking and things like that?
So the numbers are that when you take a look at graph of, farm jobs which don't require a lot of skills, right? I mean, or basic manufacturing, the numbers are that's flat over the next 20 years. Jobs that require critical thinking are like this, right? So if we're not building those skills in kids, that's what our real problem is going to be. So there's this thing called the 21st century learning skills. It's going, the next generation science standards are based on that. And those standards want to do four things. They want to improve a kid's problem solving, critical thinking, communication, and collaboration. So the entire standards are being developed. The curriculum that's for the future is based around getting kids to think and solve the problem. Now, what we're doing in Galxyz, that's fundamental to what we want to do. That the fact that, you'll be seeing this coming out in the product very soon, is we're going to enable the entire periodic table of elements and how kids are going to use them to make different materials to help unlock different gates in the game, and how they will have to really figure out, how do I move this thing forward, or what do I do with it to get to the next level? That is all being designed for problem solving and critical thinking in the kids. So any new product that's coming out over the next 2-3 years is focusing really hard on that in science. It has to be inherent in underlying engine of the product, even to the point where artificial intelligence can be used to even manage, deal with outcomes that the students are performing. So a lot of attention is going in here. There aren't many good products out there right now, but I would say in the next 3 years, there will be some amazing stuff coming out in this space. But it has to be dealt with, because those are the jobs which are growing. The other jobs aren't growing. So prepare your kid. But right now, get them into gaming. Gaming is very, very good, because you just think of, even if they play Tetris, they are different part of their brain is working on the game, because they're trying to manage all these things. And with speed, it just makes them think faster. That's the first step for you to do right now for your kid. So.
It's been an amazing evening, actually. We've kind of come to the end. Is that a quick question that doesn't overlap with anybody else?
On gaming. So I'm in the university higher ed space, and we're seeing a lot of social isolation among students in the universities. They're spending a lot of time gaming in their rooms, so much so that UC Davis is moving to smaller tables. Students aren't coming down to eat. So I'm trying to get your perspective on it's funny, yep. But it's sad, actually. So how do you view that from a, and I see a lot of gaming in the K-12, but what is the long-term effect of that in how the students will be isolating themselves as they get into their adult life and beyond? So I'm curious.
Yeah, look, so there's it's an excellent question, and there isn't a great answer for it right now, because it's a problem that's has to be solved as we go forward. Look, too much of anything is bad, right? I mean, too much of eating is bad, too much of anything is bad. The question really becomes, how do you manage what your kids are doing, right? And there's this whole thing going on around good screen time, bad screen time. That's becoming what I think the next 12, 20, or 24 months, you see a lot of it, that products and people are trying to figure out, okay, what is considered a good screen time? I think a good screen time is something that you're interacting with and that's interacting back with you. Bad screen time is sitting and watching a movie. Now, how do we stop a kid from sliding down into the deep dark hole of gaming, right? That's where the whole collaboration and working with others has to come into play. Within, in the area of science, to do science, you have to be out, you have to be experimenting, right? Now, the games you're talking about, they are, you're sitting in some crazy world, and you're meeting people, and you can be in there, right? But with what we're talking about in science, I mean, you have to apply science, and you have to come out of the room to use it. But it's an excellent question, and I don't think there's a good answer out there right now. It's something that we'll have to go through. Look, I can tell you, when I was a kid, it was used to be, don't play games, your eyes will go bad. Right? Or don't do this, don't do that, right? And parents still say it, but I'll tell you, since 6 years old, I have played so many games. All my life, I've been in front of a screen. And I don't, you know, now I'm a case of one, right? But I know many, many people whose eyesight didn't get impacted. So there are positive things in many of these things. And it's a great question for which there is no good answer yet. That's just the reality. Yep.
Great takeaway. Wonderful evening. Thank you so much, Osman, for making time for us.